ادعوني استجب لكم. This is the gift of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To call out to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at times of need, and to call out to Him even when we are not in need. My brothers and sisters, it's important for us to know this, that what we have, we do not have a guarantee it will remain with us. In fact, we are taught by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that whatever we have will be depleted at some point. This is why he says, there are the opportunities that we have in our lives that we definitely need to seize before they are overtaken by situations where we find ourselves suddenly in regret. Five things have been mentioned in one narration, and other things have been mentioned elsewhere. And it's important for us to know the health you have will never remain forever. Even if you die having been known as a healthy person, ultimately it was Allah who took the entire health away suddenly that you actually lost your life. So those who say this man died yet he was healthy, they are actually saying that he lived a healthy life and last minute he either suffered a heart attack or something happened to him and his life was taken, which means his health failed completely and suddenly. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a beautiful death where we have the shahada on our tongues, my brothers and sisters. So we need to learn that whatever we do have, there is a great chance that it may go before we know and realize. Sometimes a person is extremely wealthy and they happen not to use that wealth in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by paying the zakah and by being charitable. And suddenly something happens and they suffered a loss. Many of us know what is being spoken about. We've already tasted it. This is why when we have a lot, we need to tell ourselves, subhanallah, that it is Allah who gave this to me and it is possible that He can take it away. And so let me call out to Him now to say, Ya Allah, whatever it is you have given me, do not take it away from me. Rather, let me use it in a way that it will be a means of my entry into paradise. And if it is going to be a means of my entry elsewhere, which means not paradise, but perhaps hellfire or elsewhere, then we should make a dua to Allah to correct the way we use that gift of His, or sometimes even if it were better to take it away from us. And that is a difficult dua. When a person uses his wealth in the wrong direction, every day in the nightclub, every day in the pub, every day drinking, every day perhaps, you know, paying for wrong things and so on. And by right, if he were to realize that that is taking him closer to hellfire, he should be saying, oh Allah, forgive me for the way I'm using the wealth or I have used it. Obviously, the tawbah would require for us to regret what we've done. So we would say, oh Allah, or a person would say, oh Allah, forgive me for how I have abused the wealth that you've given me. Oh Allah, keep it with me for as long as you know it's better for me. So much so that we learn from the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he used to make a dua and he used to say, oh Allah, keep me alive for as long as you know that life is better for me. And oh Allah, take me away when you know that it is better for me to be taken away. When you know that death is better for me, take me away. If you look at that dua carefully, it's not wishing for death, because wishing for death to come out of your problems is haram. It's prohibited. But it is saying, oh Allah, for as long as you know that this life is good for me and I'm going to be using the life you've given me to get closer to you, keep me alive. And when you know that it's better for me to go, take me away. That dua is the dua of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Not so easy to make sometimes. I had one young man tell me that, you know, when I make this dua, I always think I'm going to die early because I try my best to obey Allah's instruction. Well, the truth is Allah has already declared and decreed your lifespan and mine. But what is of importance is constantly use the gift of the life you have to get closer to Allah, such that the day you and I are taken away, we would be in the best position we ever were, closest to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant that to us. So we constantly make a dua to Allah, oh Allah, do not take this gift of yours away from me, ya Allah. We have also the gift of time. A person sometimes has so much blessing, what we would term in the Arabic language as barakah, in his time, he can achieve 10 things in the day, whereas others can only achieve one or two things in the day. We thank Allah. Normally it is said when a person abstains from two things, they will have blessings in their time. What are those two things? From that which is prohibited and that which is a waste of time, futile. Futile meaning it's not beneficial nor is it harmful. It's just futile. So stay away from that which is harmful and stay away from that which is not going to benefit you at all. When you do those two things, you'll have a lot of time at hand. You'll have a lot of blessings in your time. The difficulty with us today, we sit in front of the television, we sit with our phones, we sit and chat with people when we are saying absolutely nothing beneficial, and we have wasted so many moments that were valuable that could have been used more constructively. Imagine, had those moments been the last moments of your life, what would have come of those moments? We would have regretted to say, ya Allah, you took me away. Moments before you took me away, I was busy sitting on the net, wasting my time. Or I was sitting in front of the telly or with a group of friends, just having a chat and wasting time. Imagine those are your last moments. We would rather use them to say a few words of praise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that reminds me, my brothers and sisters, many of us, mashallah, we are Muslimin, we read our salah, we try our best to obey Allah's instruction. But we lack in that sometimes we are sitting without saying anything, yet we could have declared the praise of Allah in some way. Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, Allahu Akbar. Think of it. Use those moments to say it whilst you are driving, whilst you are walking, whilst you are talking. Utter the praise of Allah. It could be your last few words. Declare anything. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluhu. There is a narration where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says there are two words that are so light on the tongue, so heavy on the scale of good deeds, and so loved by the most merciful. They are subhanallahi wa bihamdihi, subhanallahi al-azim. Imagine, the hadith says, so light on the tongue. Why don't we use our tongue to say these words? I guarantee you, I'm guilty of it as well. Sometimes days pass, or at least a day has passed, and those particular words, we have not yet uttered them with proper concentration. Subhanallahi wa bihamdihi, subhanallahi al-azim. The narration says, they are so heavy on the scale of good deeds. Who wouldn't want to do good deeds? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us. Today, if we had to place for Salatul Fajr and Dhuhr and Asr, if we had to place a monetary figure on the position of sujood here, a lot of people would rush to the masjid to say, we are collecting 500 riyal today and here is the money. The first four who come here in the front will collect 1,000 perhaps. And the others will collect 200 and so on. People will fight for the first saf. Believe me, the reality is there is something much more valuable than wealth that awaits us at every moment if only we seize the opportunity. If you utter the word subhanallahi wa bihamdihi, subhanallahi al-azim, the reward of it is far greater than anything material you can have. And yet it is so simple to utter. And over and above that, we find ourselves guilty of not uttering these words. So we should seize the opportunity of time by being responsible. Think about this particular free time you have. It may not be there. If your tongue is not occupied in anything, occupy it in the praise of Allah. It doesn't cost you anything. No one is going to charge you for the muscles of your tongue moving. Nobody, in fact, will charge you for the movement of your mouth, not at all. Rather, we would be being paid to say that in terms of reward. Allahu Akbar. Imagine if we look at it this way, that Allah is paying us to fulfill salah, but a payment not in cash, a payment in that which is far more valuable than cash, which is the ajr, The reward that we are going to get, we will be seeing the goodness of it in this world, and we will be seeing the reality of it in the life after death. And this is what makes us believers. So we are fulfilling salah for the love of Allah. But in the interim or in the process, we would like to achieve freedom from the fire, entry into the paradise, and the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We want to meet Him in a way that we are proud of what we've done. And here when we use the term proud, we are not talking of that which is prohibited, but we mean we are happy of what we've done. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us. My brothers and sisters, we call out to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us to use our time responsibly. And what is of importance is, when we call out to Allah to achieve something, when I want something and I call out to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I need to make sure that the actions of my own hands are not heading in the opposite direction. A man says, oh Allah, strengthen me so that I fulfill my salah. And at the time of salah, he is walking to the restaurant. At the time of salah, he is going away. So what was the point of just calling out to Allah, lip service, and you have been granted the energy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you are not using that energy to walk towards the masjid or to try to achieve what you've called out for. For example, a person says, oh Allah, grant me success in my examination that is coming. I want to pass my examination. I have a very, very important examination. But they are sleeping all day and all night. And they think that to call out to Allah is just like a lucky dip where you call out and it will come. Don't worry. You know, if you're lucky, you're going to get it. It does not work like that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us by giving us something known as al-asbab, the means to do something. So when we call out to Allah, like the hadith says, "Ista'in billahi wa la ta'jaz." Seek the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and do not be lazy, do not give up. When we seek the help of Allah and we are lazy, we are in essence insulting the Maker because we are not using the capacity He has given us to get towards what is beneficial for us. And this is why the same narration, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Ihris ala ma yanfa'uk." Ihris ala ma yanfa'uk. Work hard towards achieving that which is beneficial for you. Work towards it. Go towards it. You should be on high alert to achieve it. I want to get it. Then what do? Seek the help of Allah and don't be lazy. Use the capacity Allah has given you to get to what you want. Then the rest is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What this would mean is, I make a dua, oh Allah, grant me the passing of this examination. I work as hard as I can. I say Bismillah, I write the examination, then the result that comes is definitely part and parcel of the choice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'm not to be blamed because I have worked hard the best I could, I have sought the assistance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and now I'm writing my examination, alhamdulillah. So if I pass, alhamdulillah. If I fail, alhamdulillah. It is all the praise that is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But a person who makes a dua, he calls out to Allah and he did not work towards it and he was lazy. When he fails, can he blame Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Not at all. This is why people who blame predestiny, when they are actually to blame, have not understood the whole issue of predestiny. We are responsible, yes. One might say, and we definitely do believe, that it was predestined by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but you did not use the capacity that Allah gave you, so you are blameworthy. That's the difference. And this is why when a person says, oh Allah, save me from committing a sin, and they actively go towards committing that sin, they are punishable by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, although if they seek forgiveness, they will be forgiven. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from sin and forgive us for the sins we've committed and make us more conscious of sins that we stay away from them. Ameen. So my brothers and sisters, when we call out to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's important to know that you have a role to play as well. What do you want? You want to get married. So you make a dua, oh Allah, grant me a good spouse. but you have not bothered to look for anyone. You have not spoken to anyone. You have, for example, some of the sisters and some of their families believe that a female needs to just sit back and wait for a proposal to come in her direction when no one knows you exist, subhanallah, and people are just greeting you every day, not even knowing what has happened. Your father never went out to try to talk to people who have sons, for example, or to look out for lads and so on, good people. It is the responsibility of Waliyul Amr, the guardian, the one who is looking after you, to get you married. It's the responsibility of the guardian. The guardian is considered a person who has failed if he did not actively look for a spouse for those females under his guardianship. So for us to just sit back and say, you know what, your prince, and I've heard the statement, your prince is already predestined. He will look for you and come to you by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know what? It might have been predestined that your prince would probably maybe only be in the akhirah. May Allah grant us goodness in the dunya as well as in the akhirah. But if we are sitting here and we'd like a spouse here, do something about it. Say the name of Allah, seek the help of Allah, but actively search for a spouse for those under your guardianship. It is a duty upon you. And this is what we fail to realize sometimes. I have had cases where people come and complain about things where the guardian keeps on telling them, make dua. Don't worry, it will come. Make dua. Make dua. How can you continue saying do dua or make dua and continue supplicating to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when the capacity has already been given to you by Allah? Allah has given you the capacity and you don't want to use it to try and achieve. For example, if you want to drive to this masjid, if you wanted to drive here, it is not enough for you to sit in your vehicle and say, Ya Allah, take me there. Ya Allah, take me there. Ya Allah, I beg you to take me there. Ya Allah, I'm giving a charity, take me there. I'm reading this surah, take me there. I've given so much, Ya Allah, take me there. I'm your worshipper, take me there. I want to worship you, make it easy for me to go there. You have to turn on the vehicle and you have to drive. As simple as that. But sometimes we do not realize that in life, we use the opposite of that when it comes to achieving other things. Why? This was common logical example of driving. Allah gave you the car, Allah gave you the energy, you have the driver's license, you know where the place is. How dare you just sit back and blame Allah for not having gone for Salatul Jumu'ah? No, you are answerable because you sat back and you did not utilize the energy. But if a person did not have energy, if a person was immobile, paralyzed, and they couldn't even move, and they made dua, Ya Allah, let someone phone me, because if they could not phone, say they were paralyzed, may Allah protect us all and grant cure to those who have paralysis. May Allah grant cure to all those who are sick and ill as well. So my brothers and sisters, if a person is totally paralyzed, they can then say, Ya Allah, send someone to pick me up, Ya Allah. That's fair enough, because then when someone comes, it will be from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if nobody comes, the person is sinless. Why? Because they cannot achieve what they wanted to achieve. They had nil in terms of capacity. But the minute you have the capacity, you must use it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all goodness. So, if we take a look at dua and supplication, we will come to realize that it is a broad topic and it covers every aspect of our lives. Like I started off by saying, the gift of Allah is when you are in need. And this is why one narration says, when Allah loves His worshipper, He creates tests in that worshipper's life. Why tests? Why calamities? Why difficulties? So that the person can call out to Allah and worship Him in a better way. In a better way. And I'm sure we are all witness to the weakness of man. That when we have everything, you have health, you have a beautiful family, you have wealth, you have no stress, you have a good job, you have... Sometimes we come in, we will fulfill our salah with concentration levels, inshallah, that are decent. But the minute you have a problem, your concentration level is slightly better. The bigger the problem, the closer you are to Allah. So Allah says, when I love you and I want you to get closer to me, I just create a little bit of what you might term negativity in your life. But I know it is just because I want to bring you closer to me. Allahu Akbar. So, إِنَّ اللَّهَ إِذَا أَحَبَّ عَبْدًا ابْتَلَاهُ. When Allah loves a slave of His, a worshipper of His, Then Allah tests him. Allah puts these trials in his life. My brothers and sisters, when you have a trial in your life, do not look at it as something negative. Look at it as an opportunity to get closeness to Allah and promise Allah that, Ya Allah, when you take away this suffering of mine, this calamity of mine, I will not go back to my old ways, or I will not take a step backward in my worship of you, Ya Allah. Sometimes we make a dua, Ya Allah, I've suffered a loss, help me, I need to pay this payment, I need to do this and do that. And we come for Salatul Fajr, we are here for Dhuhr, we are crying after Salah, in Salah, and we are crying out to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The minute suddenly things are made easy and you've made a big profit and you manage to pay back, we find ourselves dilly-dallying even at the time of Salah. What happened, my brother? He says, no, my debt is paid now. My debt is paid now. So were you worshipping Allah only because you had a problem? If that was the case, we really have a lot to correct within ourselves. But I'd like to think and I'd like to hope that us who are here, the believers who believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we realize that even when we are in goodness, we still need to turn to Allah. We still need to call out to Allah. Ya Allah, I thank you for the gifts you have bestowed upon me. And this is why ash-shukru, gratitude to Allah, is a great act of worship. Ash-shukru ala ni'am, to thank Allah for the gifts you have, you would firstly need to sit and ponder over, what are the gifts I have? Today we are breathing, we have eyesight, we have so much. When we see others who are perhaps lacking in health or in eyesight, or they are suffocating because they have respiratory disease, may Allah grant everyone cure. Amen. We would realize immediately, Ya Allah, you have blessed me. Alhamdulillah alladhi aafani. I thank Allah who has granted me such good health, who has protected me from what he has tested someone else with. This is part of the gift of Allah upon us. So to look at those who may not have and immediately thank Allah for what you have is a great act of worship, which sometimes we lack. We look at a beggar begging and we are thinking about whether or not to give them. And we forget for a moment that the first thing I need to do is thank Allah, it's not me. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Thank Allah, Ya Allah, you have kept them in this way. Grant them ease. I really thank you, O Allah, for having kept me in a better way. I thank you for having kept me in a better way. And for that, you will become charitable to prove that this wealth is actually not yours. Al-malu malullah. The wealth belongs ultimately to Allah. He decides. And so when he has given us the capacity to give from that wealth, we should make sure that we have not been stingy or we have not been miserly, but we have actually given out. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us goodness. My brothers and sisters, difficulty or no difficulty, we will call out to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We will continue thanking him for what he has given us. We will continue trying our best to achieve greater closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We come for our prayer. Believe me, try coming a little bit earlier for your prayer. You will find great coolness of your eyes in that prayer. Imagine when the adhan used to be called at the time of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they used to achieve great tranquility just by listening to the adhan. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to say, arihna biha ya Bilal. Oh Bilal, we want that raha, we want that goodness, the calmness, the tranquility through this adhan. Call it out. Not only is it calling to success, but we will respond to it by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We ask Allah to grant us goodness and to open the doors of goodness and to close the doors of evil for us. Brothers and sisters, we take for granted so many of the gifts of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that sometimes it requires the taking away of that gift for us to realize that we actually have a gift. So instead of waiting for that moment, sit and ponder over the gifts of Allah. The fact that, mashallah, we have good weather, we have peace, we have stability, we have so much in terms of food, we have so much in terms of clothing and wealth, we have the means to, the conveyance, the transport to move from point A to point B. There are others across the globe who were wealthier than myself and yourselves just a year ago or 2 years ago. Today they are in refugee camps on the borders of their own countries. May Allah grant ease to our brothers and sisters in Syria. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open their doors. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help them so that they can have a warm winter. They have temperatures sometimes that reach below zero. We are sitting with warm clothing. But the bare minimum for us, firstly, to thank Allah for what you have. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has declared something so great. So great. He says, La in shakartum la azidannakum. If you are going to be grateful, if you will show gratitude, we will grant you increase. In every way, you will be happy, you will be content. We will grant you physical increase, spiritual increase, all forms of increase. Why? Because you are grateful. In order to be grateful, you firstly need to recognize the gift of Allah, understand the instruction of Allah, fulfill that instruction of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as best as you can, and seek the forgiveness of Allah for your shortcomings. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us all. May He make us more conscious of the gifts we have. May He make us love one another, reach out to one another, say a good word to one another. Brothers and sisters, we have this tongue. Moments ago we said, use it to praise Allah on a daily basis. Do not be miserly with your tongue. This is why, and I tell the little children, that if you keep your mouth closed for too long, it might develop a bad odor. Open it up, say something good. This is how I was explaining to the little children. Say something with your mouth in praise of Allah, or a good word to your fellow friends. We don't need to open our mouths only when we want to say bad words. Those bad words should not even be in our vocab. The reality is, we should open our mouths to say a good word to a brother. Brother, how are you doing? Do you know to ask the health of a fellow Muslim, or to ask someone's health, or if they are in need and so on, in a genuine way, is a very rewarding deed. To greet a person is even a greater reward. So much so that a believer is supposed to utter those words of peace upon all the others. So with my mouth, I've declared to you, my brother, may peace be upon you. What a powerful prayer. What a powerful declaration. May peace be upon you, and the blessings and the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imagine. When we say assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, pause for a moment to think, what are you saying? Powerful words from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, taught to us through the revelation. And yet we take it for granted. So let's use our tongues, inshallah, in a beautiful way. Let's use our eyesight to obey Allah. Because a person who wants to show gratitude of the sight they have will protect those eyes from looking at that which displeases the one who gave those eyes to us. Common logic. If a person has given you something and you use the same thing he gave you against him, that would actually be the biggest disaster. Imagine Allah's given you your ears, and we are sitting and listening only to that which is haram, which displeases Him. Through His mercy, He might give us a time. And that's why we are here. May Allah grant us goodness. May He make us repent. But if we take a careful look, we should not be from amongst those who use those ears in the wrong direction. Because how can I use the ears, earning the wrath and anger of the one who gave me those ears? How can I use my eyes to look at that which he who gave me the eyes tells me, do not look at this? How can I use my legs to walk towards a place that would anger the one who has given me those legs? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. An organ that is given to you by Allah, a part of your body given to you by Allah, and we use that part, an organ, in the disobedience of the same one who gave it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not make us from those. Gratitude requires us to use it in the right direction. Use the organ, but in the correct direction. Use it in a way that will please Allah. So you look at things that are permissible. You hear things that are permissible. You walk to places that will earn the pleasure of Allah. With your hands, you touch that which is allowed, permissible. You carry that, for example, which would be assisting people and so on. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all forms of goodness.